Thank you, Nilofer, for a nice introduction. And at the outset, I would like to thank organizers, P.D. Patel Ayurvedic Hospital, Dr. Kalapi Ji, principal of college, moderators Dr. Nilofer, Dr. Vaishali, who contacted me for this webinar and who allotted me the topic of antenatal care, or you can say Gharbhini Paricharya, clinical aspects. So I would like to clear that Gharbhini Paricharya itself as a whole is clinical. There is nothing like only theoretical in this Gharbhini Paricharya. So if we think, we have loud thinking, we can say that or we can understand that why they have given me this topic or alerted me, that I think they would like to listen some of my experiences, that various aspects of Gharbhini Paricharya all are doing in practice, or all are having experiences in various patients. So accordingly, implementation of Gharbhini Paricharya clinically can be the topic of discussion of today's webinar. So first of all, I would like to clear that in Ayurvedic classics, little variations can be seen or noted in different samhitas as per the acharyas. Charak is saying little bit different, Sushruta is saying something little bit different. So why this type of variation we can see? So Charak Acharya, if we think in the view of Charak, he is a clinician. So in the view of clinician, if any patient goes to a clinician, he will think like that as a clinician, that this and this problem may not arise in this patient, or how can we treat this patient in the view of medicine. And in Sushruta Samhita, the surgical aspects are taken into consideration. Sushruta has given instruction to avoid, to protect and prevent surgical interventions, I think. So we can say that drashta kaun hai, uske upar depend karta hai bahut sari cheeze ki hum is cheez ko kis parivrekshya mein le rahe hain. So vaise hi Gharbhini Paricharya ka hai. So Acharya Sushrut has mentioned dictum to be followed by day one. Gharbhini prathama divasat prabhriti nityam prarishta. First of all, he has mentioned that she should be in happy mood always. Prasannachit. She should remain in high spirit, prasannachit. Very nicely it is quoted. And I would like to give emphasis upon this, that I have seen in lot many patients or lot many evidences, we can see that what are the benefits. Lot many researches are done and being done upon the happiness, positivity of a pregnant woman during pregnancy. Lot many evidences are available in, we can say, both aspects, like effect of happiness, positivity, or effect of stress or negativity. So I would like to discuss or quote two, three studies which we can give, or which can give you insight or inspiration, that why we have not done this type of studies, or why we have not done this type of experiences or trial in the patients. So first of all, in a study, it was related or correlated that happiness relates with the weight of the baby. We all know that happiness relates with the weight, either healthy baby, either low birth weight baby, either IUGR, intrauterine growth retardation. Everything depends upon the happiness and the positivity of a woman during pregnancy. And for one study, that was standard Oxford happiness questionnaire was used in that study. And that included personal happiness, marital happiness, pregnancy related happiness, and psychological happiness. Personal happiness is different person to person. In Kapha Prakriti people, we can say that happiness criteria or happiness or a view of happiness is different. Their happiness level, I have seen, I think you are a clinician, you must have seen that in the people of Kapha Prakriti, happiness level is different. They easily gain weight due to their happiness level, their Saumyata or Kapha predominance in their body. So related to their Saumyata and happiness, weight can be increased easily in those patients. So like that also in the patients who are pregnant, will be happy in the we will be happy in the happy mode during pregnancy, so they can gain weight easily, or their baby will be healthy or having normal weight. That I have seen. You can also do such type of study or research that what are the relations of Prakriti with the weight of the baby first. And why I am thinking about or discussing about this happiness, what is the relation? So question is, what is the relation of happiness? What happiness is going to do? Why and how the weight of the fetus will be increased? Answer is, positivity and happiness is related to improved cardiovascular function. I think you all have seen that when a person, if he is having cardiac arrest, so in instruction given by their doctor or cardiologist are given like that, he or she should remain in happy mode. इनको कोई सदमा नहीं लगे, ऐसे बोला जाता है. डॉक्टर सभी बोलते हैं अपने जो भी पेशेंट है उनके अटेंडेंट को कि इनको खुश रखना है, इनको सदमा नहीं देना है. सो लाइक दैट इम्प्रूव्ड कार्डियोवास्कुलर फंक्शन ड्यू टू हैप्पीनेस विल और मे इम्प्रूव द ब्लड सर्कुलेशन टूवर्ड द फिटस एंड सो एज टू ग्रोथ एंड डेवलपमेंट ऑफ द फिटस राइट. इन one reference in a, if you see that while discussing upashushka nagodar leena garbha in ashtang hrida sharira sthan, tikakar arun datta has mentioned that in this patient we have to keep her happy. Ena garbhina upavishta nagodar leena kyam garbhodasyam harshayet, यानी गर्भिणी स्त्री को खुश रखो तो उपविष्टक नागोदर लीन गर्भ भी इम्प्रूव हो जाता है. तो उपविष्टक नागोदर लीन गर्भ इम्प्रूव होगा तो नॉर्मल प्रेगनेंसी में भी वेट ऑफ द बेबी विल बी इम्प्रूव. सो यू विल नॉट हैव द कॉम्प्लिकेशंस लाइक आईयूजीआर, लो बर्थ वेट ऑफ द बेबी. सो फिजिकल ग्रोथ अलोंग विद दैट फिजिकल ग्रोथ हैप्पीनेस इज रिलेटेड टू द mental status of the fetus also. In another study, it was published in the Indian Journal of Epidemiology in 2009, they have mentioned that elevated maternal cortisol level during pregnancy are associated with reduced childhood IQ. So this was cohort study. For 7 years they did this study and they did observations of those kids or those babies to whom IQ level was low, and then it was done retrospective study, and for that WISC intelligence score for children was used for this study. So कहने का भाव अर्थ ये है कि physical weight gain तो होता ही है, साथ में health of the brain of the baby is also related to the happiness of the pregnant woman or pregnancy status of that woman. And in another research, it was observed that elevated maternal cortisol in early pregnancy predicts third trimester level of placental corticotropin releasing hormone, CRH, corticotropin releasing hormone, CRH. So in the cases having history of preterm delivery, it is being very much common nowadays, you have to explore psychological status of that woman during pregnancy. So kehne ka matlab ye hai ki aapke paas agar patient aati hai jinki premature rupture of membrane ya preterm delivery ki history hai, in those patients also the relation of their happiness in early pregnancy is established in evidence-based research. So nicely Sushrut has mentioned that from very first day she should be in happy mood. Happiness during first trimester is having relation to the onset of labor, right? And in another study which was used Oxford Happiness Questionnaire at the time of delivery, labor pain coping behavior were measured during contractions. And the study concluded that higher level of happiness during pregnancy was associated with more favorable labor pain coping behavior of that pregnant woman. And this study is published in evidence-based care journals. And in another study, it is revealed that positive psychological status and emotions can have major impact on overall sleep quality of a pregnant woman. So by these examples, I'm telling you that happiness, only one word is mentioned by Acharya Sushruta, that she should remain in happy mood since pregnancy or since first year of pregnancy. So clinical importance of the sutras mentioned in Sushruta Samhita or Garbhini Paricharya. This was only one word of one sutra. And Acharya have written everything only after lot of evidences. Nothing is proved wrong till date of Ayurvedic classics. So in the patients who are having IUGR, history of IUGR, who are having their babies with low IQ, who are having problem in the onset of labor, or who are having preterm delivery. In those patients, when they come to us for antenatal care, we have to do counseling of those patients to remain happy mood during pregnancy. Is first point. One point. Second thing, important thing, Acharya Sushruta has mentioned, Drava Ahara. She should consume Drava Ahara. So after the union of Sukeshonit, there will be cell divisions. 1, 2, 4, 8 repeated cell divisions will be happen. And cell division required, cell is having surface area, that is cell membrane, and volume, that is cytoplasm. Now this cell or cells require growth, and that growth is dependent upon liquid content of the body of that female. Liquidity in the body promotes growth of new cell, that is mitosis. So physiologically, body accommodates this requirement. So in the onset of pregnancy or early pregnancy, what happens? Liquidity will be increased in the body of the female, that we say hydramnia of pregnancy, that we consider as hydramnia of pregnancy, relative anemia of the pregnancy. Cell are not being increased, but liquid is increased in the body. So GIT also, there is increased liquid. So female will feel nauseating feeling, vomiting feeling. Like this is one important symptom of pregnancy, that if female is feeling nausea, vomiting, it is indicative of pregnancy, that she has conceived. Now we all know that garbha poshan in early pregnancy or before the formation of placenta is done by diffusion. It happens upon the happens by upasneha and upasveda. And to make fetus or growing cells healthy, liquid diet is mentioned as I think. So to promote nutrients in the liquid of the body, liquid diet is mentioned. This was fetal aspect. So maternal aspect, one thing I was thinking that everything mentioned for Garbhini Paricharya in the Garbhini Paricharya has two aspects, fetal as well as maternal. What benefit is going to happen to the female? Female has conceived. Her body is also trying to accommodate that fetus. Uterus is also trying. Capacity of the uterus, as we all know, is 10 cc. Up to the full term of pregnancy, what will happen? It will having capacity of up to 5 liters or more than that. So if we divide 5000 by 10, it will be 500. So 500 times this is being growing. So it starts stretching. It will start stretching at the onset of pregnancy. Uterus is made up of Mansa Dhatu. Mansa Dhatu is made up of Prithvi and Jal. So, Jaliya content in the uterus is needed to be increased. If Parthiv content is increased, then it is not going to stretch. So, growth of the uterus along with the fetus is dependent upon Jaliya Bhav. Jaliya content is required. So, if you try, I think you all have blown balloon. In the starting, if you try to blow balloon, stretching in the starting will require some more efforts, and after that it will easily expand. Like that, in the starting of the pregnancy, uterus requires more efforts to be stretched, and for that stretch, liquidity in the body or liquid content is required. So I think water content in the body is also responsible for the stretching of the uterus. Here I would like to discuss one case. I had a patient, she was having history of abortion 6 times, and her husband was IAS officer, and all the tests were within normal limits. And they met me by chance. Not they didn't come to our hospital, but by chance in a meeting, they met me that I am working over there, and his wife is having this and this problem. And they discussed their problem. So I was taking detailed history of her, everything like that. We asked about history, that everything we ask. No? Bowel habits, appetite, stool, everything we ask. So like that, thirst also we ask. Our students are writing like BAMS, bowel, appetite, micturition and stool. So I stopped them. Don't write BAMS. So that patient was having less thirst. I asked, kaisi pyaas lagti hai? So she told specific, she gave specific history that she was not feeling thirsty, and she was used to take medicines with the juice and cold drinks. She was not consuming water, plain water. This was specific history I have noted in that patient. And she was having abortion in 2nd month on the pregnancy. Just after conception, cardiac, she go to the doctor, medical reports are okay, so urine pregnancy test is positive, cardiac pulsations are positive, present. But after that, she was having abortions. All the reports were normal. So I was thinking that maybe this factor is responsible in this case. I just thought one spark was there in my mind that I should tell her, I should advise her, and I should do counseling. But I didn't tell her that this is the cause of her abortion. So I just did counseling of her along with our Garbhini Paricharya, that you consume water. If you don't like, you use medicated water. That we advise to our patients that medicated water should be consumed. So Chandani ST Madhu medicated water I advised to that patient. during that period in first trimester of her pregnancy, and fluid intake was advised to increase. And Jeevaniya Ghat also we can advise to that patient. So after that advice and by following all the Garbhini Paricharya, she was having throughout normal pregnancy, and they were really surprised that after so many doctors and so many years, we are having this problem, abortion in second month. So in by this case, we can say that fluid intake work upon both the things, growth of the fetus by upasneha upasvet, interest stretching capacity of the uterus in the first trimester required jaliya content in the body of the female. And second thing, if we see dhatu concept, uttarottar dhatu, rasa, rakta, mansa are involved in either side, fetal side as well as maternal side. The rasa, rakta, mansa requires liquid content. So liquid diet or medication is advocated in the first trimester of pregnancy. And you see that in Garbhini Paricharya, for preventive aspect, when Garbhini Paricharya is advised, medicines are not advised in the crude form. Always it is indicated that medicated milk should be given, medicated water should be given, medicated grit should be given. So directly churna and vatti are not mentioned in the preventive aspect of the Garbhini Paricharya. Right. So liquid diet is important. And second thing I think about that why liquid diet is advised, that patient is already in Agni Mandya condition. So when we are having patients who are having Agni Mandya, we advise liquid diet. Like kisi ko fever hua hai, bimar hai, to doctor bolta hai ki liquid diet lo. Right. So in the starting of pregnancy, patient is, or sorry, female who has conceived is in the state of Agni Mandya. So in the Agni Mandya, when you give liquid diet, it will be beneficial to that particular person. So in pregnancy also, in the context of Agni, liquid diet will be helpful. Now, next indication or next instruction given by Sushruta is Madhurapraya. Madhurapraya ahara should be taken by the pregnant woman. So kalala is there. Kalala is going to be converted into peshi and then ghana. Madhuraras is made up of prithvi and jal. Cell growth is continued. Mansa dhatu is involved. Mansa dhatu formation is being done by vayu, jal and agni. And after formation, there will be predominance of prithvi mahabhuta. So to sustain prithvi mahabhuta is also required. But for the formation, contribution of jala, of madhuras will be helpful. So we think about dosha. Kapha is also responsible for regeneration or nirmana. Kapha is also made up of jala and prithvi. So madhuras is made up of jala and prithvi. So kapha dosha qualities are patience, stability, firmness, and these are required at the time of jiva when it is coming into existence. So madhurapraya ahar is mentioned by Acharya Sushruta in this context to the regeneration. But snigdham is advised, but it should be sanskritam with deepaniya dravya. Snigdha padartho ka deepaniya dravyo se sanskar karke bhojan kare. When we see ahar vidhi visheshayatan, for every human being it is mentioned snigdham ashniyat. So first aim of snigdha is Snigdha are helpful for Jatharagni. And for Jatharagni Sandukshan also, some sort of Snigdhata is always required. Secondly, if Vata Dosha is increased, Vata Dosha may harm the pregnancy. So in pregnancy state, to alleviate Rukshata of Vata Dosha, Snigdhata is required. And that's why it is mentioned that Snigdham Bhojayet. But due to the state of Agni Mandya, always it should be Sanskrit with the Deepaniya Dravya. Deepaniya Sanskritam cha. Deepaniya Dravya dwara sanskar karke Snigdha Ahar usko dena hai. And these instructions are given up to the delivery. Samanyam etat aprasavat. Up to the delivery, they should be followed. Right. So these were the common instructions given by the Acharya Sushruta. So now, what is antenatal care mentioned nowadays is systemic supervision of a woman during pregnancy is antenatal care. And this supervision includes examination and advice to the pregnant woman. So when we do any work or any task, there is a purpose why we are doing this task. What is our purpose and what will be our planning, how we will do this task and what we are going to achieve or attain by this act or by this action. So by antenatal care or Garbhini Paricharya, what we are doing? We are identifying the problems by detailed history of the patient. History, examination and advice includes in antenatal care. So examinations include systemic supervision. We take vitals of the patient. We do systemic examination of the patient, obstetrical examination of the patient. We see height and weight of the patient. Why we do this? To identify high risk group of the patients. If we identify high risk group of the patients, we can help to the patients in preventive aspect. So in high risk group of patients, what are the high risk groups? And in which cases we can do something? Like if a patient is having age less than 18 years, more than 35 years, we cannot do anything in that case. If patient is having height below 4'8", then we are not going to do anything in that case. But the patient, if they are having history of preeclampsia, if patient are having history of hypertension, of some cardiac issue, or history of premature rupture of membrane, or history of recurrent abortion, or preterm labor, in those cases, we help the patients in preventive aspects. So identification is one aspect of the antenatal care. And by that identification, we have an idea to plan further and advise accordingly to the patient. It will give you idea whether this patient should be considered in high risk group or not. In detection, we can detect the problem or complications which is going to happen in the future. We can detect at early stage. And by that, our identification at earliest will help, or we can say in our language, purva rupa of that diseased condition, you can guide your patients in preventive aspects. Okay? Prevention will be advised to the patients. And assessment. If assessed earlier, you can give primary preventive care to that patient. We can educate patients demonstration or generally what I do when we educate the patient or we advise to the patient, always call her husband or any family member. That will help to the patient and you also, the patient will follow your instructions or not. And in antenatal care, we discuss with the patient or we discuss with the couple regarding diet and lifestyle, what to be followed and what will be the place or time of delivery, what can be the mode of delivery, and we can motivate the couple to follow our instructions and advice. These are the aims of antenatal care. An examination. Examinations also we do of the patients. To examine the patient, generally we see, this is the objectives of the patient. After the aims, our objective should be to ensure a normal pregnancy with delivery of a healthy baby and healthy mother. By following antenatal care, what will happen? Baby will be happy, healthy throughout the pregnancy. Mother will be healthy, and after delivery or during labor, there can be limited chances of complications in that patient who has followed antenatal care. So these are the components of the visits. You all know that how many visits we advise to the patients. Nowadays, 4 visits are advised. For 2nd, 3rd and 4th, up to 16 weeks, 24, 28 weeks, 32 and 36 weeks. And during these visits, we do history examination and investigations. This one you all know, I'm not going to detail in this slide. But in examination, what is to be done and what should be, people emphasize upon this, like patient is paler. So you will have idea that if this patient is going to land into anemia. And if patient will have anemia, he may have complication during labor also. Baby will be having some problem also. So this is giving us idea by seeing the pallor of the patient. Pulse rate, we see 60 to 90. Respiration rate. Edema. Yes, edema is very important point to be seen or to be examined in the patients. People we see the examination too, and all the general examination or physical examination we do, that you all know. I'm not going into detail of these examinations. And these are abdominal examinations. This comprises fundal height, lie and presentation, fetal parts, fetal movements, multiple pregnancies, whether are there fetal heart sound normal or not, that we see, and abdominal scar and any other relevant finding there we see in the patients. These are lab investigations. You all know, I'm not going into detail. In subsequent visits also, we see the all the parameters, examinations, and measurement of the patient. And special emphasis is given upon preeclampsia, anemia, and IUGR. And Garbhini Paricharya, as I know, the general guidelines are given by our acharyas, some with some variations by acharyas. So in the view of Sushrut, I have discussed Samanya Paricharya. And now, what other aspects are incorporated in antenatal care? Diet of the pregnant woman, thoughts of the pregnant woman, surrounding of the pregnant woman, and sleeping and sitting of the pregnant woman. Sushrut has also mentioned that sitting or sleeping should not be very high or very low. That can harm to the pregnant woman. And surrounding should be pleasant of that female. Ahara, Vihara, Raksha Karma, and Sadhavrit. Very important aspect of Ayurveda, that is Sadhavrit of the pregnant woman is very much important. Emotional status, it is already discussed. So fetus is responsive to all the external stimuli. So understanding of that stimuli and response of the external stimuli of the fetus are recorded nowadays. So it is very much important. These are some 4D pictures of the fetus I have collected, that different expression, fetal expressions of the fetus, what fetus will give you, that intrauterine baby is having all the expressions that you can see in these pictures. And one experiment, yes, it is very important experiment, that sadhvrutta or what is of that female is very much important. And in this experiment, it was done that in a room, water was kept in two different places. And in one place, very good conversation was done with that water. And in another room, very bad conversation was done in that water. So, effect of that conversation or that language was seen upon this water content. Crystallization was seen in water content, and this was done by one scientist, Hardo, and that's why it is known as Hardo experiment. So, if water is having effect like that, so why not fetus? Why not intrauterine baby? Right. So this is very important aspect of intrauterine, we can say, pregnancy status. And psychology of mother is having effect upon the fetus. You all know that historical references of Abhimanyu and Prahlad, that Abhimanyu and Prahlad, what their mother has listened, and that knowledge was gained by them. So, sadhvrit and external surroundings is very much important, and that advice also I give to my patients, not to see Star Plus series. I should not say on this media, social media, but I generally advise to my patients that don't see these series, in those series who are Sasbo series type series, avoid those series. Mahabharata should be avoided during pregnancy, that I give advice to my patients. And reading materials should be good, music, mantras, and discussion of the subject. So paraninda should be avoided by the patients, and she should surrounded with positive influences that promote happiness and avoid detrimental stimuli is very much important. So already discussed, so I'm not going in detail. There's next lecture is also in waiting. So, masanumasik paricharya, I will discuss in short, that it is a unique, you can say, modality of our classics, that masanumasik paricharya is mentioned. Different regime in different months. First month is different, second is different, third is different. General dictum is there, but according to the development of the fetus and according to need of the mother, masanumasik paricharya, month-wise regime is different. So this is the collection I have done by all the acharyas, what they have discussed, month-wise regime, specifically different regime they have mentioned. You all know about this, so I'm not going in the detail. And Harith Sahita has some given some specific instructions to the patient in relation to the development of the fetus. So these are the various collections of the instructions of the acharyas. Yes, what I do, some specific things to my patient, I advise that I am going to give emphasis upon that. In first and second month, I advise to patients that water the plants, see the flowering. Because in the first month, there is regeneration. Fetus is growing. So if a female see flowering, if we water the plants, inner, you can say, emotions will come out, or she will feel that I am giving life to someone. So that emotion will help to the growth of the fetus. this is very much important, first and in second month, watering to the plants. In third month, worship of Panchatattva. And in fourth month, as we all know that Chaturth Mass jo bataya hai, usme Dahuradini, right? So heart of the fetus is active, and now heart is expressing emotions through the heart of the mother. So at that time, if she listen songs of bravery or Omkar, whatever you want to inculcate to your fetus, you can do. If you think that your fetus should be of Sattvic Guna, so like Omkar, if you think that it should be brave, then songs of bravery are to be advised to the patient to listen. And by this, you should identify the feeling of that woman, what she feels. It is very good and very nice concept that we are inculcating the qualities into the fetus. And in the fifth month, Gayatri Mantra is advised. Panchame manah pratibuddhakaram bhavati. So discussions of knowledgeable things to that fetus or to that female should be done, and you should advise to her husband. Family members should be involved in this. And in sixth month, I generally advise to my patients to solve Sudoku or solve puzzles. And Gayatri Mantra is advised, and to listen Deepak Rag is advised to the patients. In seventh month, spiritual promotion is advised to, or I advise to my patients. And in eighth month, that Oja is Asthir. Asthiri Bhavati Oja, mother to fetus, fetus to mother. So at that time, imagination of aura of God will help to sustain Oja in both mother as well as fetus. So you can save the patients from premature delivery by this imagination of aura or Tratak Karma. To Tratak Karma, if patient is doing, then we can save that patient also. And in ninth month, we advise her to see all the completion processes, what is complete. In our science also, classics also, it is mentioned that malina or incomplete things should not be seen by that pregnant woman. So this is indirectly giving impact upon the growth of the fetus as well as mind of the fetus. And we are doing this in practice. So I have shared with you that you can advise to your patients also. And this yogasana also, nowadays yoga is very much famous, and patients are also asking us which type of yogasana I should do during pregnancy. Patient themselves will ask you that what should I do. So in first, second and third trimester, first trimester you advise Padmasana to your patient, Kati Chakrasana, Anulom Vilom Pranayam and Sheetali Pranayam I advise to our patients in first trimester. Ek Baat Tadasana can be advised. And in second trimester, Vrikshasana and Shavasana are very much important, and Anulom Vilom is always helpful. And in third trimester, Shavasana and Anulom Vilom Pranayam should be advised to the patient. So, nutshell, pregnancy is a time of great transformation. So, if we can cure a pot full of oil, we can cure a pregnant woman. So, after that, I would like to say that let us make journey of motherhood healthy and happy with the help of Ayurveda. And now I will take some questions I have received in chat box. So I will discuss those questions with you, the patients or some persons have given. So I will see and I will answer in short. So your second session can start. I have noted those questions somewhere. Yes. Questions I have received that in the patients who are having lactose intolerance, should we advise milk to those patients or not? This was the question in my chat box. Though, so I would like to say that you can advise goat milk to those patients to be consumed. And nowadays, some plant-based milk are also alternative, available alternative of the cow milk. So you can advise to your patients in the patients who are having lactose intolerance. And second question is that what do we can give to the patients of oligohydramnios? So in oligohydramnios, generally I advise milk products to my patients, and some are doing kshirabasti also with the Shatavari Siddha kshirabasti, and some are doing Vidaryadi kshirapak are giving to the patients of oligohydramnios. In these patients also, Ajadugdha and Ajanamnit is mentioned. So you can give Ajadugdha and Ajanamnit to these patients also. And second, another question was, what should be done in GDM, gestational diabetes mellitus? So in GDM, I would like to share one my case, that she was having a previous history of gestational diabetes in previous pregnancy. And due to that, she was having shoulder dystocia in that case. And after that, her baby died due to non-proper management of that stage. So she was very much anxious that I will develop my diabetes mellitus during pregnancy, what should I do? So in that case, I have given her Phalatrikadi Kashay in low dose. From 5 ml, I gave her Phalatrikadi Kashay, and she consumed it, and then she didn't develop GDM. This was very typical case, that she was very much anxious, and I did counseling of her that keep away stress. First of all, stress is very much important cause of diabetes mellitus, as in GDM also. So stay away from stress, and Phalatrikadi Kashay I gave, and she was not developed GDM. So along with that, yogasan, meditation, pranayam also, as I told you that I advised her pranayam also. And along with that, Amlaki Guruchi also was advised. Some advice Vijay Sara, but I have not advised in that patient. Some advice Methi also in the GDM, but I have not experienced the use of Methika in the GDM cases. And one question is, what about traditional antenatal care? What are the truth and relevance? So it is already mentioned in our classics that a pregnant woman should follow the dietary guidelines advised by elderly females of the family. So I think there is no harm to follow. And according to Desh, Kala, Season, variation is advised in our classics for dietary guidelines. So there is no harm to follow the traditional antenatal care. But you keep watch upon that, and you can modify, or you can give advice regarding modification to those patients. And one question is, Ichchita Varna of the fetus, how can we have? Have you experienced some medicine or not? So I have not given any medicine for Ichchita Varna of the fetus, but I think you all have read that court case of America. I think you have read that in America, there was a couple, and they had the baby of dark complexion. And her husband went to the court, and he told that this is not my baby. And the court advised DNA test. After DNA, it was proved that it is his baby. Then they it was America. So they tried, they explored why this baby is of dark complexion. And that was the cause that she was having a cricketer, a photograph of cricketer in her bedroom. He was having dark complexion. Right. So Indriyas are very much important in the color and complexion of the eye. So surroundings that I told you, that surrounding of the female should be proper, so that effect of that surrounding is helpful in the development of the fetus. And one question is hypothyroidism in pregnancy. What can be advised? So in the patients of hypothyroidism, generally I advise that you take mini meals. Repeatedly mini meals I advised, and I have seen the effect of Ujjayi pranayam in the cases of hypothyroidism. So I advise Ujjayi pranayam to my patients who are conceived and having hypothyroidism. Ujjayi pranayam is helpful. Along with that, you can advise Ananda, Bacha, and Brahmi to your patients. And one query is that what is the antenatal care advised by Harita Samhita, or what are the difference? So I think it requires some more time. So you see my article already published, antenatal care according to Harita Samhita. You explore it, and if you are having more questions, you can ask me personally, right? And another question is also how to prevent congenital anomalies. So I think I should say Nilofer that this question required two webinars. How yes, to prevent congenital anomalies. So we can explore Garbho Ghatkar Bhava also, and all the factor responsible for congenital anomalies and aspects to prevent those. So this is also a very important question, and I have omitted Garbho Ghatkar Bhava because the time given was very less, so I cannot include Garbho Ghatkar Bhava, so I have not included, so that requires some more time. Another question was how to in the case of premature rupture of membrane, what should be done? So already I discussed that Prasanna Atma, Prasannata in the first trimester. And along with that, one study we did of Mutra Graha Hara Yoga, effect of Mutra Graha Hara Yoga in UTI. Prior to that study, we did survey study, relation of UTI with the premature rupture of membrane. So in the cases who are having history of premature rupture of membrane, you give emphasis upon history of the patient, whether she is having urinary tract infection or not, and give instructions to the patient to avoid diet which aggravate the UTI conditions. Otherwise, she may have again premature rupture of membrane, and give medications for that also, so that she may not develop urinary tract infection and by that premature rupture of membrane. These questions I have received in my chat box, and if Nilofer has received, she may tell me what are the questions further, so we can solve the questions, or if she permit time, I can answer one or two questions.
Yes, ma'am, definitely. There are some interesting questions in the chat box. One question is this: if patient is suffering with bad dreams, what should be advised? Bad dreams.
I'm not getting your...
If a patient is suffering with bad dreams during pregnancy.
Bad dreams. Okay. Bad dreams. The patient is suffering from bad dreams. So, as I told you that happiness increase the quality of sleep, right? If patient is not having proper sleep, she will have bad dreams. So, increase her happiness, 3 points that is very much important. We are not giving emphasis upon that. Prasannata, Drava Ahara and Snigdha Ahara. Nowadays, it is fashion that Snigdhata is being reduced in our diet. Dravata is being reduced and happiness in the life is being reduced. So, three of them are very much important and I have discussed. So, Prasannata, if patient is happy, she will have very good sleep and then she will not have bad dreams. Otherwise, yes, one question was there regarding Shirodhara also. I forget. You can advise Shirodhara also to the patient. But Shirodhara should not be done in third trimester of pregnancy. In first and second trimester, you can do. But in third trimester, don't do Shirodhara. Because if for Shirodhara, your patient is lying down for 40 minutes, it can harm to the fetus. Blood supply to the fetus will be hampered and patient may have supine hypotensive syndrome. Right. So in third trimester, don't do Shirodhara in the patients. In first and second, you can advise Shirodhara also. And that Shirodhara will give very good sound sleep to the patient and will not have bad dreams. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. One more question. What is the scientific reason behind asthir ojha in 8th month?
Yeah, scientific reason is that if patient delivers in that time or in 8th month, there are always chances of stillbirth. This is evidence that we can say that in 8th month, if early delivery, this is known as early delivery, right? So if baby delivers at that time, it may not survive. So this is the evidence, and researchers have also established this research. So it establish our OJA concept that OJA is asthir. If baby is delivered, it will not survive. Right.
Okay, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. And what should be given in hypertension during pregnancy?
Yeah, hypertension in pregnancy, lot many medications are there. Hypertension, in the cases of hypertension, you can give Punarnava, you can give Vacha, you can give Brahmi. Lot many medications are there. You can give. And again, Prasannata is important.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this fruitful session.